This boy, who was more preoccupied with eating than with anything else. With her head buried in the bedclothes, Sogolon wept, and her body shook violently. Her daughter, Sogolon Jamaru, had come and sat down beside her, and she said, Mother, mother, don't cry. Why are you crying? Marijata had finished eating, and dragging himself along on his legs, he came and sat under the wall of the hut, for the sun was scorching. What was he thinking about? He alone knew.
Now, of course, you understand these stories are oral stories, right? So a great storyteller is going to set this one up. So notice that Marijata is, by all accounts, a useless kid. I mean, there's nothing to suggest he's going to turn into this amazing hero that he's going to turn into. And of course, notice Solion, his mom, she's embarrassed by him. She has been humiliated by him. By the way, let's just say this out loud at 3A. The old notion of mean girls who treat each other nasty at Worland High School, that is a very old tradition where girls make fun of other girls and humiliate them, or guys make fun of other guys and try to embarrass them. This is a very, very old thing. But notice, in our story, out of that challenge will come a powerful moment that has something to do with the tree. You've got a picture of that, by the way, on 1101, don't you, right? Go ahead and make a prediction. We've always said this. Great stories challenge the reader to make predictions. What do you think is about to happen here? What do you predict is about to happen?
The royal forges were situated outside the walls, and over 100 smiths worked there. The bows, spears, arrows, and shields of Miani's warriors came from there. When Bala Fasinka came to order the iron rod, Farakuru said to him, The great day has arrived then. Yes, today is a day like any other, but it will see what no other day has seen.
1102.
The master of the forges, Farakuru, was the son of the old Nunfairi, and he was a soothsayer like his father. In his workshops, there was an enormous iron bar wrought by his father, Nunfairi. Everybody wondered what this bar was destined to be used for. Farakuru called six of his apprentices and told them to carry the iron bar to Sogolon's house. When the smiths put the gigantic iron bar down in front of the hut, the noise was so frightening that Sogolon, who was lying down, jumped up with a start. Then Bala Fasinka, son of Nankumandua, spoke. Here is the great day, Marijata. I am speaking to you, Magan. Son of Sogolon.
It's time, right?
The waters of the Niger can efface the stain from the body, but they cannot wipe out an insult. Arise, young lion. Roar, and may the bush know that from henceforth it has a master. The apprentice smiths were still there. Sogolon had come out, and everyone was watching Marijata. He crept on all fours and came to the iron bar, supporting himself on his knees in one hand. With the other hand, he picked up the iron bar without any effort and stood it up vertically.
Incredibly strong, right?
Now he was resting on nothing but his knees and held the bar with both his hands. A deathly silence had gripped all those present. Sogolon Jata closed his eyes, held tight, the muscles in his arms tensed. With a violent jerk, he threw his weight onto it and his knees left the ground. Sogolon Keju was all eyes and watched her son's legs, which were trembling as though from an electric shock.
1103.
Jata was sweating, and the sweat ran from his brow. In a great effort, he straightened up and was on his feet at one go. But the great bar of iron was twisted and had taken the form of a bow. Then Bala Fasinka sang out the hymn to the bow, striking up with his powerful voice. Take your bow, Simon. Take your bow and let us go. Take your bow, Sogolon Jata. When Sogolon saw her son standing, she stood dumb for a moment. Then suddenly, she sang these words of thanks to God, who had given her son the use of his legs. O day, what a beautiful day. O day, day of joy. Allah Almighty, you never created a finer day. So my son is going to walk.
Before you turn the page, two observations. Notice in these stories that often when you have the magic moment, when you have the thing, and in 3.1, at 3.8, you can jot down really quickly. I mean, you've seen this in a film, you've seen this in a movie where something that was considered impossible all of a sudden is about to happen. Often in these stories, when it does happen, notice there's singing involved, there's music involved, there's celebration involved, right? So for example, think about it. When our president is elected on inauguration night and all of that, we go through the inaugural ceremonies, we always have these parties where there's all kinds of music. Like, why the music? What's up with that? Well, of course, the singing and the songs that are attached to the singing, they're all kind of part of it. And in these traditional cultures, look down on page 1103, then you've always got the groat, the mind of the people. That is to say, the storyteller, the historian of the village, the groat memorized the births, deaths, marriages, hunts, wars of the people and its ancestors. Sometimes speaking or singing for days, the groat recited these events as stories, often to musical accompaniment, right? And of course, the groat was the mind of the people, an oral library of history and culture. Think how many texts we've worked with that will play the same game of trying to remember a little bit of the past. And of course, the songs that ultimately matter. Okay, let's go ahead and finish now on 1104, the end of our cutting.
Standing in the position of a soldier at ease, Sobolon Jakta, supported by his enormous rod, was sweating great beads of sweat. Balafaseka's song had alerted the whole palace, and people came running from all over to see what had happened.
Right.
And each stood bewildered before Sogolon's son. The queen mother had rushed there, and when she saw Marijata standing up, she trembled from head to foot. After recovering his breath, Sogolon's son dropped the bar, and the crowd stood to one side. His first steps were those of a giant. Balafaseka fell into step, and pointing his finger at Jata, he cried, "Room, room, make room! The lion has walked. Hide, antelopes. Get out of his way." Behind Niani, there was a young baobab tree, and it was there that the children of the town came to pick leaves for their mothers. With all his might, the son of Sogolon tore up the tree and put it on his shoulders and went back to his mother. He threw the tree in front of the hut and said, "Mother, here are some baobab leaves for you. From henceforth, it will be outside your hut that the women of Niani will come to stock up."
Now, again, Marijata, as our hero in our story here, will do something great. But that something great is motivated, right, over time and out of pain and suffering. Let's jump to 2A quickly. What's a major message for you of a text like this? It's hard to grow up. It isn't easy. But it's the pain and the suffering that will allow for us to be able to become the people that we were destined to become. This is a central message here, right? Leaders, another major message. Leaders are individuals that show courage in the face of all kinds of pain, suffering, challenges. And in that process, they become great models, role models, we might say, for the rest of the tribe, for the rest of us. At 2B, what is for you the best symbol? Is it the rod? Is it the tree? What is for you the moment in the story that you qualify as the climax of the story? What is for you the central conflict of the story? Jot down all of those. At 3A, we've mentioned a number of texts, all those great epics. For you, what's your favorite film, though, that plays this game of the moment when something remarkable happens and everybody's kind of blown away by it? If you will, what is the text that chronicles the birth of the hero, the birth of the moment of that great hero? Jot down in your senior year when we do the Anglo-Saxon poem Beowulf, we're going to reference the moment when Beowulf fights against especially Grendel, the first of the three monsters, and it will be that moment where the rite of passage occurs and everybody kind of goes, okay, this dude is some kind of serious warrior. Finally, at 3B, what is a moment in your life when you had to overcome insult? You had to stand up and do something that nobody else thought you could do. People maybe ridiculed you, laughed at you, told you you couldn't do it, and you did it. And after you did it, nobody saw you quite the same way again. Well, the power, of course, of a myth like this is that it endures, doesn't it? Thank you. I hope you were challenged.